If you will take your Bibles and turn to Genesis chapter 37, Genesis 37. So this morning what we're going to be doing is we're going to be doing kind of what we started off and on as our children's classes are doing their, staying on their schedule to read through the Bible and study through the Bible in 3 years. I've just told you that over the course of the next 3 years, we're going to kind of do touch point sermons to kind of keep us in the same territory with where our kids' classes are, and hopefully at least by the end of the 3 years, we'll kind of get at least a big picture of the Bible as we select stories from throughout. But in Genesis chapter 37, obviously, we're in the context of Joseph in the book of Genesis. And really, Joseph really serves to be a pretty powerful character throughout the Old Testament. As a matter of fact, he's one of my favorite Bible characters in the whole of the Bible, especially as I consider how this young man consistently maintained his, as we were talking about in Bible class, virtue or his integrity. He was a man of moral excellence, a young man of moral excellence. He was a man of trustworthy character as he kept God always before him. And as a result of that, the text is going to indicate over and over and over again that the Lord was with Joseph. If you're there in Genesis chapter, flip over to Genesis chapter 39. I told you 37, but I just want to show you something just really quick. If you're a Bible highlighter, underliner, Genesis chapter 39, and in verse 2, the Lord was with Joseph. Verse 3, the Lord was with him. Let's see, 21, the Lord was with Joseph. And then in verse 23, at the end of that verse, the Lord was with him again. Whatever he did, the Lord made him succeed. Now, I mentioned to you that in Psalm 105, we're going to look at this more next week. You don't have to turn over there right now, but next week we're going to study specifically chapter 39 in detail, specifically in regards to sexual temptation. We're going to kind of analyze this chapter and kind of break it down into that very specific context. We're going to do an overview this morning of the life of Joseph, and I'm just going to stress one thing about Joseph, and it's that Joseph overcame. And as we look at the life of Joseph, as we look at what Scripture continually gives us, ultimately we see a long-term vision of Jesus, even in the story of Joseph. 1 John chapter 5 is going to remind us that we can overcome through all of life's circumstances as well. Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And I just want us to be encouraged this morning as we look at the life of Joseph to realize that regardless of what life throws us, if we maintain our faith in God and our trust and confidence in God and actively live by his promises, we can overcome as well. But in chapter 39, Joseph's success was because he turned his heart to the Lord, and because he turned his heart to the Lord was always in his presence. The Lord was always with him. That's the reason for his success. But I want to show you something specific in keeping with our recent sermons on Abraham. And the long-term vision that God has as he makes his promises to Abraham, to me, it just kind of helps us see how the whole of the Old Testament is working towards a purpose beyond itself as it's seeking to point us forward to Jesus in the New Testament. Of course, we have the land, the nation, and the seed promise that through that seed, all the nations of the earth would be blessed. And I just want you to see that in the story of Joseph, big picture, that's what's happening, is that God is seeking to preserve the people through whom he's eventually going to see Jesus come through. You might remember in the story, as you've been reading this with your children at home and as you've been seeing the story of Joseph unfold, that if you go to the very end of the chapter, when the brothers are worried that Joseph is going to take their life because Jacob, their father Israel, is now dead, Joseph reassures them in verse 19, "Do not fear, for am I in the place of God? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today." If you look down just a little bit further, I want to show you something that Joseph has confidence in. As Joseph is going to die in verse 24, I want you to see what Joseph has confidence in for the future. God is going to visit you. God is going to bring you up out of this land to the land that he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And then Joseph made the sons of Israel swear, saying, God will surely visit you. You will carry up my bones from here. So Joseph died being 110 years old. They embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. What's Joseph's vision at the end of the life, at his life, is that God used him to bring about the promises to Abraham. It's kind of interesting. We think about the line of Jesus. You know, you almost imagine from the story and the fact that the Bible in the book of Genesis gives more attention to Joseph than it gives to Abraham. You might be tempted to think that, well, obviously it's going to be through Joseph's line that Jesus is going to come. It's not. It comes through Judah. But we see Joseph's role as God raises this Joseph up and puts him in a place where by his hand and the providence and the sovereignty of God, the people are going to be preserved from by the famine, which paves the way for the promises continuing to bear fruit. What do we learn about Joseph? Well, first of all, in chapter 37, we have Joseph comes first onto the scene. He's one of the 12 sons of Jacob, and he is one of the two sons of Rachel. If you've been reading through the story, you know that Jacob, by the end of it all, is going to have four wives. He's going to have Rachel, Leah, Bilhah, and Zilpah, the last two of which are going to be the handmaids of Rachel and Leah that are given to him for the sole purpose of having children when they are in the time in their life when they are not able to have them. Of course, God reopens their wounds and allows them to have children. We read about the 12 sons, the last of which is Benjamin. We do read about a daughter that Jacob has. Her name is Dinah. But the account in Genesis chapter 37 begins by introducing Joseph in a way that's very different from the rest of the brothers. Joseph is the clear favorite. This is going to be a point of hostility as it concerns his brothers. The text is going to tell us initially that his brothers are out shepherding the flocks, and Joseph brings a bad report, verse 2, back to his father. And, of course, his brothers are going to be upset over this, but even more so when it says that Israel loved Joseph more than any of the other sons. He makes him a robe of many colors. His brothers see it. They know that he loves Joseph more, and they hate Joseph. It says they could not even speak peacefully to him. It doesn't help matters any, does it, if you've read through the section. It doesn't help matters considering they already hate him. They already know he's the favorite. It doesn't help matters when he has these two dreams that basically tell his brothers, one day you're going to bow down to me. Doesn't sit very well. And we're kind of not super surprised that the story unfolds the way that it does. They end up throwing him in a pit, selling him to some Ishmaelite traders who are going to transport him to Egypt. And that's where we kind of pick back up in chapter 39. Chapter 39 is where Joseph is brought to Egypt. He's put in the home of Potiphar. He is a slave, of course. But in verse 2, it says the Lord was with Joseph. He became a very successful man. He was in the house of his Egyptian master. And just the Lord was continually with him. Summary of this, obviously we can't read everything that Genesis has about Joseph. But the summary of this story is that Joseph, text is going to tell us, is a very good-looking man. Potiphar's wife has eyes for him. She begins to notice him. She tries to seduce him to get him to lie with her repeatedly. But Joseph is a man of character. He's a man of virtue and integrity, and he loves the Lord. He doesn't wish to violate his relationship with the Lord. And ultimately, by the end of it, he flees. His garment is ripped off in her hand as he leaves, and she uses it as evidence to form a lie that he came in to try to be with her, which, of course, makes the master of the house, Potiphar, very angry. There's actually some interesting details concerning that, especially when you consider where Potiphar put Joseph when he could have easily had him killed. We'll talk more about that next week. But he's put in prison. While he's in prison, he interprets two dreams, the baker and the butler, that come true. It sets the stage for chapters 41 when Pharaoh has a dream. Nobody else can interpret it. Joseph is called for. He interprets the dream. There's going to be 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of famine. Joseph advises Pharaoh to put someone in charge of collecting food for those 7 years of plenty so that Egypt can be preserved. And that's exactly what happens. Joseph is put in charge. The famine gets to the land of his family. They come to Egypt. Eventually, end of the story, fast forwarding, I can't give you all the details. Hopefully you had time to read through that with your children. But they end up moving to the land of Goshen. And God provides for them in that way. They are being preserved and being taken care of by the providence of God, again, in the sovereignty of God. And by the end of the story, we read about Joseph's willingness to forgive his brothers as he sees everything that has happened as being within the plans and the purposes of God. That's your overview. That's quick. Quick, I know. Read it. If you haven't had time to read it, go home and read this with your families. There's a reason Joseph is just one of my all-time favorite characters in the Bible. Men of history. He's just a man of absolute integrity. A young man of absolute integrity who loved the Lord and was blessed for it in his life. Let's talk about just a couple of things as an overview of the story of Joseph to paint the idea that in Joseph's life, he overcame, foreshadowing of Jesus in his life that overcame, and God's promise for you that you can overcome in your life. Number one, let's go to chapter 39. I'm going to give you some very specific details from chapter 39. Just point your attention to some specific things that just kind of really highlight and emphasize the magnitude of what's happening here as Joseph is resisting the opportunity to sin with his wife. And again, I'm going to tell you next week, so had a meeting with the elders and was asking some questions about any sermon suggestions, and it was just brought up, a sermon might be good. We talked about role of women. A sermon might be good for the role of men and even for the role of young people. I thought about that, thought about it throughout the week, and ended up spending the majority of my week working specifically on some topics concerning young people. And turns out I have a whole lot more than I can do in one sermon. I'm going to do a short series for young people. And I'm going to prepare you for that. It's coming next week. Young people, especially if you're in the high school class, I'm going to ask you to sit up front next week, and as awkward as it may be for you, I'm going to come down to you and preach, okay? Maybe a little bit awkward, but we're going to get a little bit personal, and I'm gonna speak to you a way that I wish someone had spoken to me when I was a young person. We're going to examine some things together, and it'll be beneficial for all as we're dealing with lots of principles. We're going to start with Joseph, but really we're going to expand it out and really do a series from the book of Proverbs that I hope will be helpful for you. I think it'll be helpful for you. And so just be prepared for that coming up next week. But here in this story, I want you to look at chapter 39 and in verse 10. Chapter 39 and in verse 10. She spoke to Joseph day after day, but he would not listen to her, to lie beside her, or to be with her. Chapter 39 to me is one of the most powerful examples of a man, a young man, a man of integrity who overcame, probably it was one of the more difficult things, I would think, in his life from the perspective of one who was a young man once. I guess to some, I'm probably still a young man, but I'm just trying to imagine the scenario, and man, there was a lot going on here. As we deal with it a little bit more specifically next week, we're going to find that any really good, powerful temptation is going to present four things to you: opportunity, concealment, desire, and neglect. All four of those are here. The three of the four are here. Neglect is not here, and that's why it's his success. Opportunity, concealment, desire, and neglect. This is a perfect opportunity for a man who wants to sin and wants to be with a beautiful woman. The opportunity is there, and it's repeatedly there. The text tells us that day after day, she's continually appealing to Joseph to come and to be with me. An opportunity for concealment. Verse 11, one day when he went into the house to do his work and none of the men of the house was there, in the house she caught him. There is nobody else there. Perfect opportunity. Perfect opportunity to engage and to enjoy fleeting temptation of the flesh and to do it unbeknownst to anybody. Joseph is a young man. God put desire in Joseph just like he did for anyone. He put within Joseph the capacity to recognize beauty. Just a few weeks ago, I just mentioned when we were kind of talking about modesty and why that's so important, one of the things that any man in his right mind would say is that to a woman, there's a lot of beautiful things about creation. To a man, the most beautiful woman thing about creation is the woman. And Joseph, in this story, is just like any other young man. God put in him that desire. Now he has opportunity. Nobody will know. The text highlights the secrecy that veils the temptation to sin that the story is putting before us. How did Joseph overcome? Because Joseph didn't commit the fourth part of that formula, we'll expand more next week, and it's neglect. The neglect to think rationally. The neglect to sense the presence of God. And if you look there in chapter 39 and in verse 9, as he is responding to Potiphar's wife, he basically begins in verse 8 by saying that my master has put everything under my charge except his food and except, verse 9, you. Because you are his wife. So he highlights the fact that he has no desire to transgress his master, to offend a neighbor, to violate, or to covet what belongs to somebody else. But in verse 9, he is so in tune with the presence of God that he responds to this woman, how could I do this and sin against God? And it's just, when sin is easy, when sin can go unnoticed, the most powerful weapon that you and I have is to not neglect the sense of the presence of God. He knew that he would be in the presence of God. He knew that wherever he went, no matter how he had convinced himself that he was going to remain concealed, he could not flee God's presence. And the idea or the thought of having a disrupted relationship with God was more valuable than whatever fleeting sin he was going to enjoy with this beautiful woman. And so the text tells us that not only did he not engage, but look at verse 10. I think this is important. She spoke to Joseph day after day, and he would not listen to her. Why would he not listen to her? Because he was so in tune with the voice of God. He would not even entertain the idea of doing something that would disrupt his relationship with God. The idea really comes back to this in Proverbs 9:10. Joseph was a man who overcame because Joseph was a man who more than anything feared the Lord. And because he feared the Lord, he hated the thought of sin. Because he feared the Lord, he took firm steps, not questionable steps. Because he was a man who feared the Lord, he was not a man who was interested in going into questionable places. Can I just draw your attention to something really quick there in verse 10? He would not listen to her, to lie beside her, or to be with her. Did you notice the significance of that word or? It's not that he just wouldn't be with her. It's that he wouldn't lie beside her. You know what I think's happening? I think probably what's happening after a while is Joseph is turning this woman down, and so she's trying to present an option to him that would lead him into sin but wouldn't be as blatantly obvious at first. Just come lie with me. Just come keep me company. Come keep me warm like the woman that was brought into David's bedroom. Just come be with me. I'm lonely. But he wouldn't listen to her. He wouldn't lie beside her or be with her. Why do you think that that's the way it turned out? I think it's because he feared the Lord. Proverbs chapter 7, we read about a man who the text tells us lacks sense. And his sin, by the end of it, that cost him his life, is the product of his lacking the sense to take only ways that are firm. The text tells us in Proverbs chapter 7, he walked in the way of the adulteress. Whether or not he had intentions to be with her from the beginning is not given to us in the text, but when he walked her way, he made his first mistake. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And when we have that fear of the Lord, we hate the thought of evil. We do not go to places that are questionable. We do not do things that are surrounded by question marks and knowing that it's going to present a unique opportunity for us to sin. In Ecclesiastes chapter 12, the whole of the matter, when all has been said and heard, is fear God and keep his commandments. And that's what we read about Joseph. We read about Joseph being a man who overcame when sin was easy, despite the fact that it was going to cost him much. When Joseph flees that last time, she catches his garment, she shows it to the master, she lies about Joseph, and Joseph is thrown in prison. The text is going to tell us that he's there at least for a few years. If you look there in chapter 39, beginning in verse 21, chapter 39 and in verse 21, the Lord was with Joseph. He showed him steadfast love. He gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. The keeper of the prison put Joseph in charge of all the prisoners who were in the prison. Whatever was done there, he was the one who did it. We obviously have some time that's passing in order for Joseph to build this rapport with the prison keeper. And by the time we get to the time when the cupbearer and the baker have their dreams, it's really unknown. There's not really any indicator as to how much time passes between when Joseph is put into prison and the time when the cupbearer and the baker's dreams are interpreted, but obviously enough time at least for him to establish his integrity with the gatekeeper. But we do know at least this, that even after Joseph interprets the dreams of the butler and baker, chapter 41 and in verse 1 tells us it's not till 2 years later that Joseph is actually remembered and recalled out of prison. So Joseph is at least in prison for quite a few years on account of something that he was falsely accused of. That was a consequence of a righteous decision. He was abandoned in prison for something he did not commit as a stand for righteousness. You know, Joseph is not unique in this. This is often something that happens in this day and in this time, especially for those who are of Christ. When we do what is right, there are consequences even for doing what is right sometimes. And in 1 Peter chapter 4 and in verses 15 through 16, as Christians in this age, oftentimes doing what is right will actually get you persecuted. But the call of Jesus is the call that was administered to Joseph by nature of his relationship with God. In verse 15, don't suffer as a murderer, don't suffer as a thief, don't suffer as an adulterer or a meddler. But if you suffer as a Christian, don't be ashamed. Let him glorify God in that name. You know, I almost wonder if the reason Joseph rises to such a place of prominence, even within the prison cell, even coming back to what we talked about in Bible class, is because he was a person of virtue and a person of integrity. It was because, despite what happened to him as a product of making a very good choice, his spirit wasn't harmed by it. I almost wonder if the reason is because he knew that he was suffering for righteousness and because he knew that the Lord was with him as a product of that, and because he was assured in that and not in anything else. I imagine Joseph going to the prison cell, spending time in prayer to his God. I imagine Joseph counting his blessings. I imagine Joseph saying, okay, this is where I'm at. I'm going to do the best that I can, leaning and trusting in the Lord all the way through. And so even in prison, I'm going to work heartily as unto the Lord. And it's very clearly seen in this context that the Lord is with Joseph to such an extent that he's put in charge of all the other prisoners. The gatekeeper has no concern over anybody who is in there. That's verse 23 of chapter 39. because whatever Joseph did, the Lord made him succeed. God just continues to bless Joseph. As Joseph just continues in all of life's circumstances to acknowledge him. In 1 Peter chapter 4 and in verse 19, it's really the call for Christians today as we consider what's spoken of there. Don't suffer for doing wrong. Suffer for being a Christian. If you look there in that text in verse 19, continuing to entrust yourself to the Father while doing good. And that's what I read when I read the story of Joseph. Is that when sin was easy, when lies were told, he just continually entrusted himself to his Creator. And he did good, whatever good that he could. He kept his gaze and his eyes upward. He trusted that whatever happened, God was going to bring something good from it. He realizes what that is in the end. He entrusted his soul to a faithful Creator. And he overcame. One more section. As you fast forward to the end of this, as Joseph interprets the story, Joseph interprets the dreams of Pharaoh in chapter 41. Of course, he's put in a place of prominence, really second command over the nation of, or the kingdom of Egypt. And it really sets up the stage for when his brothers are going to come and they're going to seek food. And there's a lot of drama that takes place, you know, pretending for a while that he doesn't know them. You've read the story, I'm not going to get into that. But there's some drama that unfolds, and there's some trickery that takes place as you kind of put yourself in Joseph's shoes, and you're like, man, that was mild compared to what I'd done. As he's planting stuff in their bags and sending them away, and then he's catching them along the way and accusing them of theft. And we think, well, that's pretty mild compared to what I would have done. But you fast forward, and you see the heart of Joseph. As he sees his brothers, despite the fact that they betrayed him, despite the fact that they sold him, despite the feelings that he probably had from time to time over the past however many years, Joseph, despite all of it, turns out forgiving them. How do you imagine the brothers felt when Joseph revealed himself? I imagine they were terrified. As a matter of fact, the end of the story we already read, after Jacob dies, they were terrified they were going to lose their life. Joseph reassures them, though. But when Joseph first reveals himself, I can't even begin to imagine the feeling that they must have felt in that moment. As they immediately go back in their minds to the time when they stripped the coat off of him, threw him in the pit, took the money from the traitors, presented his coat covered with blood that they planted in order to send a false narrative, and they presented that to their father. Wonder if even they might have remembered the days, weeks, months, and years that they witnessed the tears of their father, whose love was wrapped up in young Joseph. I wonder if Joseph, when he first sees his brothers and realizes who they were, gets hit with the chill of the cold, dark pit. I wonder if he remembers the time when he's being driven away on that wagon and he sees the faces of his brothers for the last time, holding 20 pieces of silver in their hand. I don't know. I don't know what all transpires, but I know this. When resentment was understandable, Joseph, a real man who lived in history under these circumstances, sets an incredibly powerful example of forgiveness. Going back to chapter 50, one last time, Joseph said to them, "Do not fear, am I in the place of God? As you meant this for evil against me, God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. Do not fear," he says. "I will provide for you and your little ones." And he comforted them, and he spoke to them kindly. When I read the story of Joseph, I see a living example of what Paul writes to the Roman brethren in Romans 12:21. "Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. And that's exactly what Joseph does in this scenario. We've looked at just very quickly three different things. When sin was easy, when lies were told, when resentment was understandable. Each one of those thoughts and those ideas, forgiveness and overcoming temptation, and dealing with false accusations and persecution. You know, we could expand those out, but really the specific contexts of each one of those was not really the main idea this morning. It's to look at the story of Joseph from a bird's eye view. And what we see when we see the life of Joseph given to us by Scripture is that Joseph was a man who overcame the world he inhabited. All of the hardships that came with his life, all of the injustices that were shown to him, all of the lies, the temptations, the losses, and disappointments. Again, I'm not suggesting that Joseph was a perfect man, but what the Scripture reveals to us is a man who, when you consider the whole of his life, was a man who overcame by his consistent commitment to the reality that he was in the presence of an almighty God. He was a man who was lied against. He was a man who overcame temptation. He was a man who endured great persecution and hardship. And he was a man who forgave when it seemed nearly impossible. And already can you see that he might just be, in a sense, a shadow of something better to come. When I see the life of Joseph, I can't help but think about Jesus. In the wilderness, when he's there with Satan and he's tempted in those three ways, all of which would have been very difficult to overcome. Opportunity, concealment, desire. But the one thing he refused to neglect in that circumstance was the will of God. It is written, I'm going to yield to the will of God. I'm going to live for the one who is my Father, and I'm not going to fulfill myself in this way. One who was lied against continually. He was arrested for false accusations. They blasphemed his name. They accused him of being exactly who he was. And because of the lies of sinful man, Jesus took up the cross and was persecuted and murdered and killed. Resentment would have been very understandable from the perspective of the cross, but yet we have a man hanging on the cross who looked out at those who put him there, uttering the prayer, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. And behind all of this self-sacrifice, we remember the teaching of Jesus in John chapter 10, in verses 17 and 18, when he says, nobody takes my life from me. I give it of my own will. And so we see that Joseph overcame, but he's but a shadow in his life of someone much greater, who would overcome the seed promised to Abraham, by whom all the nations of the earth would be blessed, who took the hardest of injustices that life had to throw and overcame as one who continually saw himself in the presence of the Father and on whom the presence of the Father was clearly proven. But of course, the point in all of this is simply this. Joseph overcame, so can we. God preserved Joseph's story to give us confidence for faithful living. Yes, Joseph had a part to play in the grand scheme of the fulfillment of the promises of Abraham. But so much is given to us of Joseph's life because it is something by which we can take incredible encouragement from. You remember John chapter 5 and in verse 4, John 5, 4, this is what John has to say by inspiration of the Holy Spirit as he's writing to Christians. He says in 1 John 5, 4, everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. How have you heard me typically define faith? Faith is actively staking one's life on the claims or the promises of God. And that's not my definition. It comes from a book that I have, and it's just the best definition that I've ever come across. But faith is actively staking one's life on the claims of God. And Joseph understood as long as he walked with God, God would walk with him. As long as he was a blessing, that God would bless him. That as long as he trusted in God, that whatever hardship he had to endure, ultimately God would work it out for his good. Even if he didn't experience that good in his life, God would fulfill his purpose and do something incredible. Joseph continually actively staked his life on the presence of God, and he overcame in this life. And 1 John 4 says, everyone's been born of God, overcomes. This is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. I think a lot of times we have the misconception that perfect faith or mature faith or complete faith requires perfect, complete, mature conditions, and that's just not the case. The incredible thing about Joseph's story is that it was the worst of conditions, yet his faith prevailed. His faith was incredible. And ultimately, through it all, God got such precious glory through the life of this young man. Faith doesn't require the perfect conditions. As a matter of fact, what we see is that God intentionally lets us go through imperfect conditions. Even in the 23rd Psalm, yes, he leads us beside still waters. Yes, he leads us to greener pastures, but sometimes we're led through the valley of the shadow of death. As we see a God who is trying to produce something in us, who's trying to grow our faith, but also a God who's trying to work out things that are much bigger than us, through us, that we don't always understand. Faith doesn't require the perfect conditions. Faith actually grows the fastest in imperfect conditions. And so I don't know where everybody in this room is at this moment as far as your life is concerned. Things are going well, things are not going well, things are going terrible. I don't know. But I do know this. Joseph is an incredibly powerful example, especially in those times, of one who refused to take his eyes off the Lord because he realized that his life served a much greater purpose than just himself. He realized that even if he was overcome in his trial and even if death took him, he knew his faithfulness would be his glory and his victory. Joseph overcame because he lived as one who had a constant sense of the presence of God. And because he lived with a constant sense of the presence of God, the text tells us over and over again, the Lord was with Joseph. Joseph overcame by faith. You can overcome by faith. Let us be a people who are committed to living with a constant sense of awareness that we are always in the presence of a holy, awesome, faithful God. Maybe it is there's someone here this morning who is not yet a child of God. You know, it was talked about much in Bible class this morning that the reason the measure of virtue and integrity is the virtue integrity of God. It's the reality that despite in this world we are always constantly let down by this and by that. One of the most incredible things about God is we have one in whom his character is always trustworthy. He's faithful. We know that his character is a character of goodness. It is a character of love. It is a character of justice. And there are a lot of things that we can talk about, but he is one who always wants and does what is truly best for us in light of the purpose for which he designed us. And that's demonstrated most fully when he sent Jesus to die on the cross for your sins and my sins, to show the immeasurable amount of love that he had for you and I. And the invitation is universal. If you are here this morning and you're tired of living in the muck and the mire of your sins and living a life of disappointment and a life of hopelessness and you want hope for the future and you believe what the Bible says about God, and that God is the one who created this earth. It didn't happen by chance, that he does exist. And you believe Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6, that God rewards those who seek him, just like he did Joseph. And I'm going to ask you a question. Will you step out in faith? Will you yield yourself to him? Will you submit your life to him? If you will, the gospel call is, will you confess his name, having believed? Will you change your life? Will you repent of the way that you've been living and live in a way that's pleasing to the Lord? Will you be baptized, Acts chapter 2 and verse 38, for the forgiveness of your sins, that you might receive the gift of the Holy Spirit? And will you live faithfully as one who is always aware that he's in the presence of a mighty God, a holy God, and be faithful to him all the days of your life? We want to help you in that. We're ready to help you if you're ready to make that decision, or if you've made that decision and you've strayed from the way and you want to come back and you need the prayers of this congregation. We stand ready and willing to pray for you as well. Whatever your need, let us know by coming forward as we stand and sing.